Hello, everybody. I'm Megan Kane, and today I will be your host for Stata Happy Hour. This week, I am super excited to introduce the distinguished professor in both the sociology and the psychology and neuroscience department at UNC Chapel Hill, as well as the longtime lecturer at ICPSR and author of my favorite structural equation modeling book, Dr. Ken Bollen. Thank you for being here, Ken.
Well, thank you, Megan. it's great to be here. I've enjoyed, you know, Stata, and you know, used it for a long time, and saw one or two of these happy hours, and enjoyed watching them. So, thank you for asking me.
Oh, we're so happy to have you here. So before I get to my first question, I wanted to remind all of you watching at home that you can also ask Ken questions in the chat box in whatever platform you're viewing this from. And I will do my very best not to take up all of Ken's time today so that we can get to a couple of those at the end. All right, so you've seen a couple of these happy hours before, so you probably know that we always start them the same way. And we ask our guests how they found statistics. I imagine if I could ask 5-year-old Ken what he wanted to be when he grew up, he probably wouldn't say sociology professor or statistician. So at what point did you realize your interests in both of those fields?
I think you could have asked the 18-year-old Ken the same question. I assume that this is true for other people too. It's a roundabout route that got me into statistics. I do know that as you're going through school, you know, you're better at some subjects than others. And in my case, I was better at math than other subjects. And so the type of positive reinforcement I would get going through school, a lot of it would be in math. I did go through public schools, but I had some very nice opportunities. I mean, one opportunity I had was in eighth grade. They had taken a few students from our math class to teach Fortran programming at the time.
Cool. And
so, yeah, that was a real surprise because I knew obviously nothing about programming at that age. I think it was 13 or 14, something like that. So that was kind of a unique experience. I don't think I fully appreciated how nice it was to do it at the time. It was a bit of just sort of following what the adults tell you to do. And so it did come time to graduate from high school. I am a first generation to go to college. I didn't know a lot about colleges either, but my family and teachers encouraged me to go to college. They recommended probably a small liberal arts college that it might be easier to find my way around. So I started college at Stetson University, a small liberal arts college down in Florida, in Deland, Florida. And at the time you had to say, what major would you like to have for your studies? And of course, I really didn't know, but I just went to math because that's what I was used to. And so I had a lot of math that first year at Stetson University. And with that intensive coverage of it, I found that I wasn't as interested just in dealing with definitions followed by proofs and then a new definition followed by proofs. There wasn't a lot of discussion about possible applications. So it was fairly abstract, you know, approach to the topic. I did leave Stetson after the first year and went to another small liberal arts college, a place called Drew University in New Jersey. And I switched to sociology major because I felt that it was much more applied oriented. And as part of that, I had my first introduction to statistics, which was a introductory statistics course. This was not geared toward sociology majors. This was a university-wide course. And so they didn't orient it to our particular subject matter. I enjoyed that fine, but didn't feel that I wanted to be a statistics, you know, major or anything of that nature at that point. I was then encouraged to go on to graduate school, and I went on to Brown University in Providence, Rhode Island, in a PhD program in sociology. And I think in that graduate program, I really had more experience, more exposure to statistics. The required course sequence that we had there, they used an econometrics text at that point. And that's where I really started to gain an appreciation for statistics. I really liked the, and to this day, I love the way econometricians clearly lay out assumptions and then talk about how to detect violations of them, what are the consequences of them, what are the corrective procedures, you know, that you can use. So I started to enjoy that and started to appreciate how, what a valuable tool this was to study a wide variety of problems. There also happened to be a sociology professor who knew a lot about factor analysis there. And so I took a factor analysis course. And this exposed me to the idea of how you can actually deal with variables that are very difficult to measure. So that when you have latent factors, latent variables, that there actually are techniques that can enable you to study that quantitatively. And I think the last major influence there, and I'm not quite sure how this came about, but I had an RA position, and they were allowing me to read technical articles in mostly in sociological methodology, sociological methods and research, and then give a presentation to the faculty and graduate students, kind of a translation, you know, of these articles. And I did that probably 4 or 5 times. And it was fairly popular, and I learned a lot, you know, by having to do that and having to explain it. And that got me more deeply involved. And I guess the other influence, as I think about it, is while I was in my third year, finishing up my third year in graduate school, I went to the ICPSR summer training program in quantitative methods. ICPSR, it's a long name, Inter-University Consortium for Political and Social Research. And they've had a long running program in quantitative methods there. And I spent the summer there, and it was my first exposure to structural equation models, Tukey exploratory factor analysis, Box-Jankson time series analysis. So I learned a tremendous amount in a relatively short period of time. But I have to say, even at that point, I was a little skeptical about structural equation models. But I was intrigued enough that when I saw a workshop being offered, a 3-day workshop by Carl Droskog and Doc Sorbonne, developers of the LISRO program, they had a 3-day workshop in 1978. Went to that workshop. I remember I had this little green notebook that on the inner cover, I had taped the Greek alphabet because I wasn't that familiar with all the Greek letters. And I knew that LISRO used a lot of them. And so I attended that, and I was just so impressed with the presentations, the skeptical questions I had about it. I thought that Carl just handled them really well. Gave an answer where there was one and said, well, there's still more research needed on that. And I think that really gave me a sense of the power of these structural equation models and how you could combine statistics with substantive knowledge in a coherent whole, you know, and control for measurement error, and really get closer to the way in which I think in terms of combining substantive and statistics. So this, I'm already heading down this path now at this point, you know, towards statistics. Then what I did is I requested in 1980, this ICPSR program at Michigan. I asked them, I knew they needed, the person who had taught me structural equation models wasn't doing it anymore. And so I asked them if I could teach it. And they decided to take a chance on me. And that was in 1980 when I did the first course. At the time, I was actually working full-time at General Motors Research Labs as a research scientist. So it was about in Warren, Michigan. So this was about an hour and a half commute. But they allowed me to come in really early, put in my 8 hours, and then drive to Michigan. So this was 5 days a week for 4 weeks, and teach this course. So that was really great. I mean, I learned, I think any of you who have taught, you know that you really learn the subject thoroughly when you have to teach it to somebody else. I mean, it's a great experience to really get the depth there, because there's all sorts of questions that people are asking that force you to learn things, or are questions that you don't think of yourself.
Yeah, you don't realize how much you don't know until you try to teach it to someone.
Exactly. That's one of the benefits of teaching. I really, to this day, I still appreciate it. So I continue teaching that, and then I thought, mistakenly, well, gee, I have these detailed notes in teaching this. It should be very simple for me to put this into a book. But it actually took, I think, probably 7 or 8 years from the time that I had that idea about how simple it was to the 1989 book, The Structural Equation Models with Latent Variables. And I would say writing that book, that was the most intensive training in statistics, you know, that I had, just trying to prepare that and put that together. So that was the road.
Wow. So did you start writing this book while you're still at GM, or had you made the shift back to academia by that point?
I think I had shifted. So in 1982, I went to Dartmouth College. And at Dartmouth, I started writing it.
Okay. So what made you want to get back into academia? Was it this structural equation modeling course?
I think it was more, I wasn't sure if I wanted to have an academic position or a non-academic position. The General Motors one I had was a terrific one. It was part of a think tank where you would come up with topics of your own and just convince management that these were worthwhile topics to look at. And so you had a broad latitude. You were working in a multidisciplinary group. We had applied mathematicians, operational researchers, psychologists, sociologists, economists. It was headed by a physicist. The department was, and it was called societal analysis. So it was a terrific job, but I also realized that it's far less frequent to move from a non-academic into an academic position than the reverse. And I thought, well, I should, if I'm curious about it, I should probably, you know, give it a try before it's too long that I've been outside. So it was mostly that.
Got it. So working in multidisciplinary groups has been a long time theme in your career, it sounds like.
It's true.
Are you familiar with that quote by John Tukey? Something like, the best thing about being a statistician is you get to play in everyone's backyard. Would you agree with that?
I fully agree with it. It's wonderful. So that's one of the things that I do enjoy when I'm working with people on other projects where the other person is a substantive expertise, you know, on that topic, you know, learning about that topic through that person. And just in the modeling aspects, you have to know a lot about the topic. I think you would find many people who do consulting. And if you're dealing with statistics, you probably do a lot of consulting. I find that 9 out of 10 questions that I get are actually substantive questions. You know, well, what variable should I put in? Well, you know, that's a substantive question. Or how should I put it in? Should I, you know, use the square term? Again, you know, these are all substantive questions. So it's it's funny where I think a lot of our training keeps statistics and the substantive issues so much more separate than they should be. I mean, they should be, to the extent possible, an integrated whole, because each depends on the other, you know, when you're putting them together.
Especially in structural equation modeling, I think. If you don't have a substantive theory, then what are you doing?
I fully agree with you. It's one of the interesting aspects of the structural equation models is that you see fewer people that are trained within the discipline of statistics using them compared to other disciplines. And the reason is pretty clear. It's unlike other techniques. You know, you have to put together a model, which is a test of a series of hypotheses of how different variables are related to each other, how variables are related to their indicators. And without some knowledge of the area, you can't do it. You know, you can't do it without some kind of substantive speculation.
Yes, and I think you really stress that in all of your work, which I appreciate a great deal.
Oh, well, thank you. Yeah, I just think it's really true. It is an unusual part of these structural equation models. I would put DAGs are in that category too. That's another type of non-parametric structural equation model where you have the model first, you know, and to build the model first, you need that substantive understanding.
Mm-hmm. So when did you first start using Stata?
You know, I was thinking some about that, and I believe my first exposure to it was, I told you I kept going back to teach at ICPSR each summer. I've done that for a long time, 40 years in fact.
Impressive.
Surprising to me that it's been that long. But I believe my first exposure to Stata was probably through the summer program when I would go back there, and it was growing in importance. They were using it, you know, more and more. So you'd see it in more and more programs and courses, you know, being used. And so that would naturally, you know, get me curious about it. I think the second influence was at the University of North Carolina, where some of my colleagues, I believe it was probably some of my econometricians and economist friends that were using it and talking more about it. There's a center at the University of North Carolina called the Carolina Population Center. It's one of the largest in the world, and they are very multidisciplinary, and they have people working on all sorts of problems in collaborative groups. And there you would see Stata being used, and even to this day, you know, a fair amount. So.
And what is your role there?
At the Carolina Population Center? I have two roles there. One role is as a consultant, a statistical consultant for the trainees and the faculty fellows that are affiliated with the center. So if they're looking for advice on best techniques to use, software, you know, to get that's appropriate for a particular one, they will ask me or someone else, you know, for guidance on that. The other one is as a faculty fellow of the center. And so this is people who are doing population related research that affiliate with the center. So I have a number of projects in the population area that often do involve structural equation models. And I collaborate with people over there on those topics. For example, we just found out last week that a graduate student, Ilya Gutin, and myself, who have a paper that will be published there, which is a longitudinal model of self-reported health over time, where we're allowing for measurement error, and we're trying out which different longitudinal models best describe these data. Quite often, one of the points we make here is that people often choose longitudinal models out of habit rather than out of a systematic examination of what might be most appropriate for the data. So there's some work that I've done with a colleague where we've developed a very general longitudinal model where you can specialize to most of the major longitudinal models that are in practice by setting certain parameters to zero or not, and see which of these models is best fitting. So you can see if a, for people who are used to econometric type models, fixed and random effects model, if that's most appropriate, latent growth curve model, simplex model, latent difference score model. I can go on and on. Autoregressive, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Oh, that sounds really interesting.
It was really helpful on this project where we, if you looked at the literature and how people have been modeling it in the past, you'll find just a wide variety of different models that they're using for sometimes the same data set. So it turns it into an empirical question, you know, rather than doing this because the study that came before you was using this type of model. You can, if you don't have, and unfortunately we often don't have sufficient theoretical guidance on what particular longitudinal model we should use. In that common situation, this says, okay, if you think it's an autoregressive, fit that, but let's see what happens if you add parameters that would capture growth curves. Or if you have an autoregressive latent trajectory model, what would that look like? Do you really need the combination of growth curves and autoregressive, or can you just get away with an autoregressive or just a growth curve? So it turns it into an empirical question.
Yeah, I would imagine working with so many different departments and disciplines that you would need a more general model. At least I assume people from different fields use structural equation modeling differently, or do you think it's all about the same?
Oh, I think you're right in saying that there are different traditional longitudinal models depending on the discipline. However, truth doesn't care what discipline you're in. You know, you want to, you know, you want to see what best matches the data. So, if you're coming to this as an econometrician, what they do is, if they're being a little bit more systematic, they may compare a fixed and random effects model with a Hausman test, which is what it's used. And so they're trying to choose between just those two models. Right. But that's a very limited menu because the fixed and random effects model can be embedded in a more general model. So you can actually see if that more general model is doing better than that fixed and random effect. And I'm sure that you could take lots of published applications out there and put them into this type of framework to determine whether actually there might be a better empirical fit, you know, for the data that you're looking at.
Yeah, I agree. So I'm getting a question from YouTube, which is, what is your view on the future of SEM and integrating it into machine learning?
Ah, I wish I had my colleague, Oscar Gonzalez, here. He's a assistant professor in our quantitative psychology program, and he's looking at the integrating of machine learning and structural equation models.
Oh, really? I had never thought of those two as being related, because machine learning is so data-driven and SEM is so theory-driven.
Well, I think that there's you're right that the classic forms of both are like that, but at the edges, you're starting to see a little bit of integration and some work trying to pull them together, because there is at times uncertainty. I'll give you a good example within the M Plus program. They have a feature about that combines kind of exploring whether additional factor loading should be entered into a model and whether that is leading to a poor fit or not. So in that sense, they're doing a search procedure, Bayesian-based search procedure, to see if additional loading should be brought into play or not. in some of the work that I do on what is called model implied instrumental variables of approach to structural equation models, there's room for machine learning type of activity in that with this approach, you can have many instrumental variables possible for a given equation that are just part of the rest of the model structure. Machine learning can sometimes be helpful in trying to tell you from an empirical point of view, which of these instruments would function the best, would give you the greatest efficiency at the smallest number. So there are these areas where there's some uncertainty and having a type of empirical search procedure could be helpful.
I mean, is that kind of similar in theme to modification indices, or do you think that's a separate thing?
Yeah, that, you know, that's a good question. Modification indices are trying to tell you what single parameter, if you freed it up, entered it into the model, would lead to the greatest reduction in the chi-square. So there is a empirical element that's telling you about possible modifications to the model. The difference between that and what I was talking about with the choosing of instrumental variables is that if your model's correct, it doesn't matter which group of instruments you get from the point of view of biasing coefficients in the actual structural equation. See, it just has to do with the efficiency of it. And so there's less importance. If the model is correct, you could use all of them and you still would be all right, or you could use a subset of them and you still would be all right. They would still be consistent estimates of the same parameter. Now, with the modification index, if you incorrectly loosen up a parameter, put it into the model, there is the potential that that would, you know, bias your coefficients.
Got it. That makes sense. All right. So we're going to finish up pretty soon here. But something I was curious about, you've had so many different roles and positions in a wide variety of centers and all sorts of things. So I was wondering if there is any one of those in particular that you have found to be the most rewarding.
Wow.
I know you have a lot to choose from.
I've had fantastic positions, you know, opportunities. I feel very grateful, and not even knowing these were possibilities, you know, that even being a professor, you know, when I was just starting, getting out of high school and the rest, I knew next to nothing about what that would be like as an occupation. You probably don't know what that's like even when you're in it. So I would say to some degree, I kind of like the variety because it taps into different aspects of your personality, your skill set, and the rest of it. And it gives you a chance to develop and to grow in ways that you wouldn't have otherwise. So if you always did the same thing all the time, you know, you could get very good at those particular skill sets, but and that's fine. That would be fine. Everybody's different. But I kind of like trying different things, you know. So I would say the variety was quite good. Yeah, the going back to the General Motors one, that was a fantastic opportunity. I mean, incredible things were being done at the time. Just to give you one example, there was another sociologist there. Carol Deweese was his name. And this is in 1977. He had hooked up a computer to the news feed of the Detroit News, which was the major newspaper in Detroit. He was reading off text from that and was using it to see if it was a good alternative to public opinion polls. So you could track over time different issues, different terms, Sounds like Google Trends, right? I mean, yeah. Sort of for people, but this is
in 1970s. You know,
yeah.
Wow.
So they were doing that, you know, at that time. The first time I heard about global warming was there. It was a woman physicist. I'm not remembering her full name now, but she had projects on that, looking at possible greenhouse effects. I mean, there just was a whole series of really interesting projects there. There was, I remember there was another guy, traffic safety guy, was looking at risk behavior, and he had figured out, he was measuring risk indirectly, trying to see if people who had an orientation toward risky behavior were also the ones who were not wearing seatbelts.
Mm.
And to do that, what he looked at is he measured how close people were following other people, tailgating or not. And then he had a shot to see whether there was any use of a seatbelt or not, to see if they were associated. So there are all sorts of just, you know, fantastically interesting and creative projects, you know, going on. And that's, you know, that's the appeal in the university as well. There's lots of great research going on in lots of different departments. So for me, it's really paid off to go out, get to know other people, collaborate with other researchers.
Yes, I think it's given you a very broad understanding of structural equation modeling and the other models you've worked on. All right. Sorry, I think that's all the time we have for today. But okay. Thank you so much for being here. We really appreciated you participating in our Stata Happy Hours. And thank you, everyone at home, for tuning in. We appreciate your viewership and your comments. And I hope you all have happy holidays.
Thank you, Meg. Goodbye.
Bye.